Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. The topic for today's webinar is COVID-19 and MIS-C, if I can call it, is Multisystem Inflammatory Syndrome in Children, also known as PMIS-C in USA. Why it is important? Because till now we used to think that the complications are not there in children and COVID-19 is not involved in children, and we had the report of 2 to 3 cases in our newspaper also that COVID-19 patient presented as Kawasaki disease-like syndrome. And today this webinar will also be a tribute to Dr. Tomisaka Kawasaki, who died exactly 10 days back on 5th of June in Tokyo. In fact, he was a pioneer who told us about the Kawasaki disease. So for this webinar today, we are three of us. Firstly, myself, Dr. Bakuni. I am from the Army. After I became a senior citizen 2 years back, I came to this hospital and working here for last 1.5 years. And I did my training in clinical immunology and rheumatology from Sanjay Gandhi PGI in Lucknow. And with me, our younger colleague, Dr. Himanshu Batra is there, who is a graduate of Grant Medical College, Mumbai. He did his diploma from KIIM Hospital, Mumbai. After that, he came back to Delhi, did his DNP in pediatrics from Mata Chanan Devi Hospital. Then he worked as a consultant for last 10 years in one of the corporate hospitals of Gurgaon. And for last 1 year, he is heading the Department of Pediatrics in Manipal Hospital, Dwarka. And the third and most, precious member of our today's webinar is none other than Dr. Smita Mishra, who is MD Pediatrics and FNP in Pediatric Cardiology. She is the Secretary of the Indian Academy of Pediatrics at Delhi Chapter. She is the current head of the Department of Pediatric Cardiology in our hospital, Manipal Hospital, Dwarka. And she's the past president of National Pediatric and Fetal Cardiology Forum, which is a branch of Indian Academy of Pediatrics. And the most one of the most important things she has done is she's the author of disability criteria for the cardiac patients, which she has wrote single-handedly, of course, with the help of others, but she had the main roles. Previously, she had been the editor in chief of the IAP bulletin and the executive board member. She has been the co-authors of drugs in pediatric cardiology. She also won the best doctor award in IMA 2013. And the role of Dr. Smita will be after our younger colleague Dr. Batra presents, she will be the moderator. She will be asking the questions from me as well as Dr. Batra. And in between, I think she's a big fan of Karan Johar also. She will be having coffee with Karan type of questions, like rapid fire round. And in rapid fire round, out of two, whosoever wins, our coordinator, Dr. Sakshi, who is sitting right far away from me, has promised that she will give a hamper. And preferably, she should give me the hamper because I'm introducing the topic. Now, with this small introduction, I hand over the webinar to Dr. Himanshu Batra for the overview of COVID-19 and multisystem inflammatory syndrome in children. Over to him, please.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Darshan, for introduction. So straight away, I am coming to the topic. So the topic for today is COVID-19 and multisystem inflammatory syndrome in children. First of all, I would like to pay our tribute to the great pediatrician, Tommy Seiko Kawasaki, who died at 95 years of age just 2 weeks back. Contents of today's presentation will be just a brief introduction to COVID-19, followed by clinical presentation in children and multisystem inflammatory syndrome, and just a brief overview of Kawasaki disease, and then we will conclude the session with questions answered from. Just a brief introduction. In December 2019, after a cluster of pneumonia cases which were reported from Wuhan City in China, the CDC in China named this virus as the novel coronavirus, and which was renamed on 11th February 2020 as SARS-CoV-2 or COVID-19, that is coronavirus disease 2019. It was declared as a global pandemic on 11th March 2020. Globally, we have seen around 8 million cases so far with around 4.5 lakh deaths, And India also, it is still in the rising phase with more than 3 lakh cases reported and nearly 10,000 deaths. And it is estimated to affect more than half of the world population if stable vaccine doesn't come on time. Now, the transmission of COVID is by the droplet route through the aerosol which are generated, and by inhaling those directly or through the nose, eyes or oral route, and also by touching on the surfaces which are infected with these droplets. Clinical spectrum in children and adolescents. So far we have reports from the major studies from the US and China, and which have reported around 2% only, 2% affection only in the children less than 18 years. Usually it is less severe. And there are a lot of hypotheses which are coming why it is less severe in children. First is regarding angiotensin converting enzyme 2 receptors, which are found in less number in the on the nasal epithelium and respiratory epithelium in the children. How it played a role, it is yet to be stated. Then there is a lower exposure so far of the children due to isolation and the containment measures carried out by the government. And also there is high likelihood of virus co-infection, which is responsible for limited replication of SARS-CoV-2 in this setting. And more importantly is the role of innate immunity induced by the virus vaccine or the BCG vaccine in the children. But there are two concerns in the children. One is how they will behave in the transmitting this infection once the lockdown is over or once schools are open, that needs to be found out. And the second more common concern is the multisystem inflammatory syndrome, which is now recognized since last 1 or 2 months after the peak of the cases in European and US countries. In children, around 50% of cases either present as asymptomatic or just as a viral prodrome, that is mild UTI like illness, with fever, cough, sore throat, running nose, which can be easily missed with other symptoms. And 40% cases present with lower respiratory tract infection or pneumonia, of which 40% are just mild pneumonia, hardly requiring hospitalization. Those present with fever, cough, and mild tachypnea. And severe pneumonia with the fever, cough, dyspnea, oxygen level below 90% in the room air or cyanosis, that is seen only in 5%. And critical cases, those presenting with ARDS, respiratory failure, shock, encephalopathy, cardiac failure, or multi-organ dysfunction is seen in 0.6 to 2% only. Now the unusual inflammatory illness, which is recognized since last 2-3 months in the European and US countries, where this disease has already peaked. So it is reported approximately 1 month after the emergence of COVID-19 in Europe and US. It presenting varied presentation was seen in form of prolonged fever, headache, abdominal pain, vomiting, rash, and it is associated with shock in more than 50 to 70% of cases and organ dysfunction. And the more prominent feature noticed in these is the raised inflammatory markers like CRP, raised counts, raised ESR associated with lymphopenia and low albumin. Typical Kawasaki disease features were seen in around 20-30% of those. And the majority were found to be SARS-CoV PCR negative, but serology test was positive. That is IgG or IgM levels for the coronavirus. Now in Italy, they have reported around 30 times increase in the incidence of Kawasaki disease in a 1.5 month period of 18-20 to 28 April. That is, they have reported 10 cases compared to 19 cases which they have seen in last 5 years before that. And the key features which they have noticed in these cases are, there is evidence of seroconversion to COVID-19 in form of IgG or IgM antibodies. There is higher rate of shock compared to normal Kawasaki disease, and it is affecting mainly older children around 8 to 9 years. Multisystem involvement is noticed in form of abdominal symptoms, meningeal sign, and myocarditis. And associated features of macrophage activation syndrome in terms of inflammatory markers were seen in significant number of cases. They have more severe disease course and resistant to IVIG was noticed, and need of adjunctive steroid was there. In similar condition was reported from France, where they named it as Kawa COVID-19. And in those, they have found 16 cases. The presentation in those cases, but the main symptom were gastrointestinal in the 81%. And along with that, the typical feature of Kawasaki like cervical adenopathy, fever more than 4 days, rashes, cracked lips, conjunctivitis, these all features are present. And the other thing which they have noticed are the symptoms of neurological signs in the form of headache. And the coronary dilatation or echo findings were noticed in 19% of those cases. And myocarditis was seen in around 86% of severe cases. So now the question is what we are actually dealing with. It is just a Kawasaki disease in a severe form, or it is similar to something what we have seen previously with staphylococcal or staphylococcal toxic shock syndrome, or it is a form of macrophage activation syndrome only, or cytokine storm, we can say. Now to cover answer this, the WHO and CDC have come with this entity, multi-system inflammatory syndrome in children, and which case definition proposed by WHO is that it is labeled in children and adolescents age 0 to 19 years who have persistent fever lasting more than 3 days, and two of the following features. One are the feature of Kawasaki disease, that is rash or bilateral non-coronal conjunctivitis, mucocutaneous inflammation signs associated with hypotension or shock, which is not seen typically in all Kawasaki cases. Features of myocardial dysfunction in form of pericarditis, valvulitis, or coronary abnormalities in the echo. Raised inflammatory markers from the heart point, that is troponin or pro-BNP. Evidence of coagulopathy, acute GI problem like diarrhea, vomiting, abdominal pain. And associated evidence of inflammation in form of elevated CRP, procalcitonin, ESR, ferritin. And no other microbial cause like bacterial sepsis, staphylococcal, streptococcal is ruled out. And along with that, there is evidence needed for the COVID-19 as per WHO criteria, either in form of antigen test or positive serology, or even history of strong contact with COVID-19 positive patient. CDC has just done some minor modification in this thing, that is the age included is less than 21 years in this, and fever for more than 24 hours is considered as a criteria for the CDC definition. Inflammation can be predicted by any marker like CRP, ESR, fibrinogen, D-dimers, ferritin, and associated lymphopenia or low albumin. Critical severe illness is a major criteria in this, with more than two system involvement, cardiac, kidney, respiratory, hematology, and there is no other possible other diagnosis that needs to be ruled out. And along with that, evidence of COVID-19 infection. But they have also said that any pediatric death occurring with evidence of SARS-CoV can be included in this criteria. The UK, they have labeled this entity as pediatric multisystem inflammatory syndrome temporally associated with SARS-CoV-2. And in this spectrum, we see either just febrile children with inflammatory markers, but no evidence of Kawasaki disease and no multi-organ involvement or shock. Then second in this is a Kawasaki disease-like cases. And third is inflammatory with multisystem involvement. So this is a spectrum which was seen. The criteria included were almost similar, that is, fever more than 4 days with either GI symptom, rash, conjunctivitis, evidence of inflammation, and presenting either as classic Kawasaki disease, incomplete Kawasaki disease, or with cardiogenic or distributive shock. The treatment which was tried in all these conditions was mainly supportive in form of oxygen, mechanical ventilation for few, fluid resuscitation or inotrope for the shock, and just fever medicine. IVIG was given in all the cases who have the presentation like Kawasaki disease, and in the cases which are refractory, methylprednisolone was used, and aspirin high dose for the Kawasaki-like patients. Then few immunomodulators, a few drugs like anti-interleukin-1 anakinra or anti-interleukin-6 tocilizumab was also considered. Anticoagulation was given. Hydroxychloroquine is used at trial in few of the cases. Just a brief overview of Kawasaki disease before finishing this presentation. Kawasaki disease we know since very long time as acquired self-limiting vasculitis involving mainly medium-sized arteries and especially coronary arteries. And it is more commonly seen in Asian and less than 5-year-old children. And peak age is 18 to 24 months. And it is one of the leading causes of acquired heart disease in US and Japan. And exact cause we don't know so far. And it is considered as aberrant immune response to some infectious agent. Diagnosis rests on the clinical feature mainly. The criteria for diagnosis are fever for at least 5 days, along with presence of 4 of the following conditions, that is oral mucosal changes in the form of erythema of writing or lips, strawberry tongue, erythema of pharyngeal or oral mucosa, bulbar conjunctival pination bilateral without an axillary and limbal sparing, cervical adenopathy, usually unilateral and more than 1.5 cm diameter, skin rashes in the form of maculopapular or diffuse erythroderma, edema of hands and feet in acute stages and periangual discrimination in the subacute stage, and there is no other non-cause. Just to show a brief view, these are mucosal changes seen in the Kawasaki, and typically we see that there is no exudative discharge compared to the common differential diagnosis of Kawasaki, which is measured. Cervical adenopathy unilateral and rashes in the form of polymorphic rashes, acral changes like swelling in the acute stages, and in subacute stages we see discrimination. Main differences what we seen in this syndrome, that is multisystem inflammatory syndrome and Kawasaki, that we are seeing older children more affected, more severe myocarditis is seen, Abdominal pain and diarrhea is very prominent symptom in these cases. Shock and multi-organ dysfunction is very common. And there is marked increase in inflammatory markers, suggesting a different pathology than Kawasaki disease likely. And lymphopenia and low platelet count, which is in contrast to the Kawasaki disease. And in the treatment also, we are seeing resistance to IgG in these cases. So just to conclude, this multi-system inflammatory syndrome associated with COVID-19 can present as varied combination of Kawasaki disease and Kawasaki shock syndrome, and we have to be alert on this. And the pathogenesis looks to be uninhibited immune response to prior COVID-19 infection, not direct viral injury, that is cytokine syndrome. And in some genetically susceptible individual, like in those studies, mostly African or Caribbean patients were noticed in these countries. And the method-wise, this is happening may be similar to what we are seeing in dengue. That is, antibodies enhancing this thing or causing cytokine storm, that still needs a lot of study. And this has an important implication when we are considering development of vaccine, whether they can do more harm by producing these kind of antibodies, which are more pathogenic, or they will form protective. So now I will invite Dr. Smita Mishra to moderate the session, and just question answers are invited from all the participants.
So Tommy Saku Kawasaki, somebody wrote about him that he was Sherlock once picking up about the Kawasaki disease, and Charles Dickens when he was writing about those findings. So I must say that 2 months back, we were thinking that pediatrician will not have any role in this COVID pandemic until evidence started to emerge that children have different way to present and may have a critical disease and Kawasaki-like presentation. As the pediatric cardiologist, let me assert that Kawasaki disease is close to my heart. There are 25% chance of having long-term complication in the form of coronary artery aneurysm, particularly if the aneurysm are more than 8 millimeter large, and they can lead to a life-threatening event in less than 10% of cases, but definitely they can. Then on the other hand, Kawasaki shock syndrome is a rare thing. Actually, people started recognizing it in 2009 onwards. And this is very rare. In our own series, we found 25% of coronary artery disease, but only one girl child having Kawasaki shock syndrome. And it was very, really difficult to control whole scenario. The patient was admitted under Dr. Arvind Taneja, and everybody knows Dr. Arvind Taneja for his, because he was the person who reported first case of Kawasaki disease in 1979 from India. So definitely Kawasaki shock syndrome is immunologically mediated. It causes myocarditis, it causes cardiac dysfunction, capillary permeability, and so forth. Critical COVID positive children have worst kind of multi-system involvement, as we have learned just now from Dr. Himanshu. Congrats, Dr. Himanshu, for excellently setting ball rolling for the today's webinar. So let's discuss. Coming, first question goes to Dr. Himanshu only. Do you think a new name is needed? Are Kawasaki disease or mucocutaneous lymph node syndrome accommodate the spectrum of symptom in MIS in children?
Definitely we need a new name for this thing, because Kawasaki disease, as the name itself shows, that it is just showing the mucocutaneous lymph node involvement only, as the main features. But in this syndrome, what we are now seeing after COVID, we are seeing more multi-organ dysfunction, more shock, and very high level of inflammatory markers, anti-inflammatory markers, which are seen in the body. So we definitely need to include all of those things. That is, it is a multi-system, it is including inflammatory, and that's why it is labeled as multi-system inflammatory syndrome in the children. And the mechanism is also seems to be different in the compared to Kawasaki disease.
So Dr. Bhakuni, what the difference between toxic shock syndrome, Kawasaki shock syndrome, and MIS?
Very nice question, ma'am. The toxic shock syndrome can occur at any age, number one. Number two, there will always be a history of infection in the past, maybe post-surgery, maybe post some injury, or in trauma to skin barrier. So there's some amount of infection we will get either in the history or in the examination. And if we do the culture examination of the blood, it may show bacteria in the blood culture. Whereas in Kawasaki disease, as you said, yourself said, the shock syndrome is very, very rare. However, if we see a COVID-19 with MIS or multisystem inflammatory syndrome, where the patients are usually elderly children, right from varying from 1 year to 20 years of age as per the Americans, and WHO says right from 1 year to 18 years or 19 years of age. But the average age of these children coming as a shock with COVID-19 positive or maybe negative is 9 to 11 years. And they have the atypical features in most of the cases. Atypical features are Kawasaki disease, meaning thereby they do not fulfill 4 out of 5 criteria along with the fever. They may have only 2 or 3 criteria out of this Kawasaki disease. And they have more of the GI symptoms like diarrhea, nausea, vomiting in 81% of the cases. And most of them, around 86% patients, they come with myocarditis, some arrhythmias, and pericarditis in 25% of the patient. And if we do investigations, the C-reactive protein goes, you know, almost 40 times more than the normal, meaning thereby more than 200 units. Serum ferritin goes more than 1400 microgram per liter, which is not there in the case of either TSS or in cases of Kawasaki disease. And of course, D-dimers are highly raised. So that's how we differentiate toxic shock syndrome with MIS-C.
Okay, so coming to Dr. Himanshu, you have told us just now, but again a brief description of classical symptom of COVID-19. Do you get anosmia in children also? And what about GI symptom?
The classic symptoms of COVID-19 in children are mainly the fever is the most prominent feature, along with that cough or respiratory symptoms, flu-like illness is seen. And GI symptoms are seen in around 10% of cases in form of diarrhea. But that can be a major source for the transmission later, that needs to be seen. Because of fecal transmission, we still are declining. But with the diarrhea and these kind of symptoms, it can be a major source. And regarding anosmia, firstly, the children doesn't report such specific symptoms more precisely. And also, as far as the pathology is concerned, the ACE2 receptor which are there, they are found in less number in the nasal epithelium of children. So that may be the reason they don't show that much anosmia compared to what we are seeing in adult patients.
So, Dr. Bhapuni, what is the cytokine storm? We keep on listening that cytokine storm is region for every issue related to COVID-19. And does it happen in children also?
I'm glad you asked this question, because as you said yourself, everyone talks about cytokine storm. I'll tell in a very, very simplistic way, if we see the normal course of action, what happens when an antigen in the form of bacteria or virus, it comes to the body, it is taken by the antigen presenting cell, that is APC. APCs, they take the antigen inside and they process it. After processing, it goes to the cell surface. There it meets the MHC class 2, you know, protein. With the help of this MHC class 2 protein and this processed antigen, they go to T cell receptor. And the T cell receptor takes it and it stimulates the T cell to secrete cytokines. But what happens in normal, you know, infection, day-to-day infection, these T cells, only 0.01 to 0.1% of T cells are involved. So they give limited amount of cytokines to the body to fight that antigen. But what is happening here in COVID is very necessary to know that COVID-19 virus, it does not go through the antigen presenting cells. It attacks directly the T cells, and it attacks not 0.1 or 0.01%, it attacks 5 to 30% of T cells. Just imagine, 30% of T cells, if they are attacked directly and they are stimulated, the cytokines, they just flow like an uncontrollable, you know, river in our body. So that is cytokine storm. And in the bargain, what happens? The T cells also secrete gamma interferon. Now, what is the role of gamma interferon? They go and suppress B cells. And the function of B cell is to produce immunoglobulins. So the protective antibody production is also suppressed. So it is a double whammy condition for the body. At one side, 30% of T cells are giving us plenty of cytokines, so they are damaging our body. And on other side, the protective antibodies are not being, or they are being suppressed to be produced. So the protective antibodies are not there, and the attacker is there in the form of cytokines. So this is called cytokine storm in simple language.
Okay, so Dr. Himanshu, coming back to antibodies only, as Dr. Vapani said, we know significant antibodies are formed in COVID-19 also. So are they pathological, are protective, or they are really not significant so much, as everybody is waiting for that herd immunity will come from protective antibodies. So what is the status of antibodies production in COVID-19?
Antibody production is seen in all the cases after the COVID-19 infection, as measured by the various tests which are detecting IgG as well as IgM levels. The thing is that whether they are protective or not, that yet needs to be found, because they have seen some neutralizing antibodies, but they can't be sure whether they are sufficient, whether they will give long-lasting immunity. And with over cases of MICSC as we are discussing, they are proven to be pathological. It seems that they are behaving similar to like dengue, that is the antigen. They are actually enhancing the antibody, which are enhancing the disease process, either by enhancing the viral replication like thing or forming the immune complexes, which are damaging the body actually. So it is yet need to be found out. So that's why when we are considering vaccine, we need to do a large safety trial first and see whether they are harming or not, or any side effect are occurring or not in these cases. So antibodies are definitely forming, but they are protective or not, that yet needs to be found out.
What is your opinion, Dr. Bhapani, on this antibodies? Are protective or not?
Ma'am, till now it has been proven that they are not protective. The neutralizing antibody, firstly, they are few in numbers, few in quantity. And secondly, it has not been proven by any experiment that they are protective at the moment. Natural antibodies I am talking about. There are anecdotal reports that it may be protective, but we cannot say by surety.
Okay. So, Dr. Bhagwan, it is said that severe COVID-19 disease is characterized by exhausted lymphocytes. What do you mean by it?
Well, if we go back to my answer of your last question, ma'am, as we said, around 5 to 30% of T cells are already tired of, you know, giving the cytokines, and B cells are being suppressed forcefully, that don't produce antibodies. Thirdly, this is adaptive immunity. So adaptive immunity is being compromised, as well as the innate immunity is also compromised in the form of NK cells. It has been found that during the COVID-19 infection, the number of NK cells and CD8 cells, they go down. Why? Because there is an increase in the inhibitory molecule of NK cells known as NKG2A. So that suppresses the natural killer cells. So innate immunity is suppressed, adaptive immunity is suppressed, or our immunity, you know, is in a shambles. So our immunity is suppressed. And it has also been seen that once the patient starts convalescing, this inhibitory molecule NKG2A, it goes down. As well as NK cells, CD8 cells, CD4 cells, everything increases. So basically, this is the exhaustion of the immunity, your immunity or the immune cells by working more. Whatever their function, they are made to work more and some are made to work less.
So do you think, Dr. Himanshu, all the like this exhausted lymphocytes and this cytokine storm is a normal phenomena in every case, or is just a rare phenomena? What do you think?
Okay, it is not normal.
Every patient, or is not happening in every patient? Yes or no? A little, just brief answer.
It's not seen in all the cases.
Not
seen in all the cases.
Okay. So, so do you think a cytokine storm happens in children also?
Yes, sir, definitely. So cytokine storm we have already seen in the cases of hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, or in few familiar cases as well. So this is happening in children, is a very known entity. And after few viral infection like Epstein-Barr virus, we have commonly seen this thing, and few other viral illnesses as well in the past also, which have the intracellular pathology. Even in malaria also, sometimes this kind of condition is seen. So it is a common thing, and in immunodeficiency, it is a well-known fact. when the immune, basically the cytokine storm is happening because of the imbalance between pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory mediators. So whenever the viral load is more and the antibodies are less compared to that thing, at that time we can always see the cytokine storm.
So question number 8 actually has been answered already. So I go to next is, that is, are you want to say something significant? Yeah. Antibodies are formed in body in COVID-19. Are they pathological or protective? So probably yeah, answer that.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. They are not pathological, but as I said, they hardly provide any immunity because they are usually produced after 2 weeks of this thing. What I want to add that since the immunoglobulins are produced in less number or the antibodies are in less number, if we treat these patients, we have to give double dose of IVIG. Like in Kawasaki disease, we just give 2 g/kg body weight one day or 400 milligram in 5 days or so. Here, the condition comes that patient does not show any improvement within first 10 to 12 hours. Then we have to give a second dose. What does it show? It shows that the body is lacking the neutralizing antibodies against COVID-19. Similarly, in cases of tocilizumab or anakinra, because of the cytokine storm, we have to give to double dose also. Around 66% of the patient, they require the double dose after 8 to 10 hours of tocilizumab. Again, it shows that there is a river of cytokines of IL-6 there in the body. So basically, that is the answer, that immunoglobulins are not protective, which are produced naturally in this case.
So how important is interleukin-6? You have just said interleukin-6, you named it. How important is interleukin-6 in deciding the management plan?
Interleukin-6 causes all the damages. It's basically pro-inflammatory cytokines. So inflammation goes regardlessly all over the body. And how do you know it? As I told you, ma'am, the C-reactive protein increases by 30 to 40 times. The serum ferritin goes high, sky high, more than 1400 microgram per liter, as well as D-dimers. The prothrombotic state also increases. So IL-6 has got a role in all these things. If we control the cytokine storm, most of the patients, they recover. In fact, out of in New York, few weeks back, out of 150 children treated with tocilizumab and other drugs, only 3 died. That shows the importance of one of the drugs was tocilizumab to prevent the cytokine storm.
Dr. Himanshu, how much importance you give to monitor interleukin-6?
Interleukin-6 has a role when we are treating it. Normally we see the normal inflammatory markers like the CRP, ferritin, and based on that we usually prefer steroids. But if we see that no response is coming or interleukin-6 level, because they will not report, will not come immediately. But that is one line available to us. If we are seeing poor response to initial therapy with IVIG or with our steroids, then we can consider based on the IL-6 level.
Interleukin-6 can you do routinely in India, in Delhi? Interleukin-6 level can we do in India? Delhi, we can do. What is the meaning of aberrant development of acquired immunity, Dr. Himanshu?
Normally, the acquired immunity or adaptive immunity, we call that is a specific immunity formed against a particular antigen after its exposure. So, in few cases, when this immunity, the antibodies which are forming, instead of protecting us, they are helping further in the viral replication, that replication of the disease, or they are forming immune complexes which are damaging the body. So in these cases, we call it as aberrant development of the adaptive immune response, which we are well known with the dengue strains, that we know that when a particular dengue strain is changed, so the antibodies which are formed, they act against the body and they cause more damage, enhance the basically disease.
So how do you, Dr. Bhakani, how do you interpret the coexistence of Kawasaki disease with COVID-19, specifically in children? Is it a predictable association?
Well, ma'am, it's not a predictable association, more so that we can call it as a post-infectious complications. Why I'm saying so? For the one or two reasons, because the MIS or the multi-system inflammatory syndrome in children, it develops 2 to 4 weeks the exposure of the children to COVID, not immediately along with COVID infection, number one. And we can correlate with reactive arthritis in rheumatology, like the infection like UTI, conjunctivitis, and other infection, they take place today, and the joints are involved after 7 days, 14 days, 21 days, or within 28 days. So basically, there is no correlation, but it is a complication of infection. We can safely call it post-infectious complication of COVID, but no association otherwise.
Okay, so now we have completed our 10 questions. So we are going for a rapid fire round now. Five questions, rapid fire round. So the questions are like myth or fact. So whoever says, first thought, Sakshi, please keep counting. So children are immune to COVID-19 infection. True or false?
Not immune, but they are less vulnerable.
Okay. So, in fact, infants are worst affected than pediatric age group.
Yes. Definitely.
Children may be nasopharyngeal carrier and can shed virus in a stool for a longer period.
Yes. Both of them.
Evidence exists that closing the school brought down number of COVID patients in some countries.
Definitely. No evidence, but schools are now objecting. They are resisting. They want that school to
what
grow.
Did you say?
Definitely, it has played a
major role. There are evidence, yeah, he won. So,
is but there is no evidence. Of course, yes.
There are evidence. Then diarrhea less than 10% is common than the cough.
Yes, 4 out of 5 cases they had diarrhea more than other symptoms.
Coming to other question, right?
Yeah.
Sakshi, this was round one. Okay. So, Dr. Himanshu, WHO says now we have to live with COVID-19. Do you think it's going to increase the incidence of Kawasaki disease in general?
From the US and Europe experience, it looks like that it will increase. It is just a temporal association. It is not a causative relationship. But definitely, when we don't know the exact pathogenesis, why it is happening, whether antibody which is formed, it is causing this kind of condition. So it is very much likely. Because even the cases which were seen in those countries, the child were asymptomatic for the COVID, or they were just a mild symptom they have shown. And just asymptomatic cases developing this condition after a few weeks. So it is very much likely that we are going to see a surge in number of Kawasaki. And similarly, we have already seen few cases in India as well so far.
So, Dr. Bhakuni, triggers of Kawasaki disease have been a mysterious puzzle. What is your response to a statement? Now we have found a link between flu coronaviruses and mysterious Kawasaki disease.
Actually, ma'am, no direct causal relationship has been found. However, there was a study published in 2005 in Journal of Infectious Disease that they found the New Haven coronavirus in cases 8 out of 11, that means around 72% of the cases were having New Haven coronavirus by RT-PCR. So that time they said, well, there is definitely a correlation of New Haven's coronavirus as well as Kawasaki disease. If you leave that study, we have not found any evidence of any association till now, except of course now this COVID-19 MS, they have the correlation in the form of post-infectious complications, as I told earlier.
Do you think this is a new understanding about the COVID relationship between Kawasaki disease and COVID, and new opportunity to look for the link?
Yeah? Absolutely right, ma'am. Absolutely right. We have at least some clue that, look, this virus can also be involved in causing Kawasaki disease. Maybe atypical features, who knows, that it has a definitive role in that. Of course, more work is required.
So, Dr. Himanshu, is there any role of adult practices like hydroxychloroquine, prophylaxis, azithromycin for the children also?
No, ma'am, it has not been recommended or approved by any of the authorities so far. In the adults, we are using this as an immunomodulator mainly, hydroxychloroquine as well as azithromycin, because we know that the mechanism by which coronavirus is acting, or after just entry of the body, it causes decrease in the body's immune response and it enhances its replication. So if we use immunomodulator early in those cases, it will help in reducing the progression to severe one. But in children, as we have seen that most cases are already mild, and the severe cases which we have seen, they are not associated with the virus load as such. So I don't think it is of any help in the children so far. Hydroxychloroquine as well as azithromycin.
What is the role of IVIG? How effective is IVIG in children with MIS?
Ma'am, there is a very, very definitive role of IVIG. As I told you, that neutralizing antibodies produced in the body of the children, they are not enough or sufficient to suppress the inflammation. So we have to give IVIG, so much so that we have to double the dose. As I told you, in one of the studies, they found that 66% of the children who recovered, they required double dose of IVIG. So there is a definitive 100% role of IVIG in COVID-19 infection in children.
So this double dose should be given like after one ration and another ration, or it should be like you have to decide and you just continue with the double dose?
Around 34 to 35% of the patient, they responded to one single dose. Say if you have given IVIG today, and within 12 to 24 hours, the patient showed improvement clinically as well as by inflammatory markers also. However, if the patient does not show any improvement within next 24 hours, we have to repeat the dose after 24 hours, same 2 gram per kg in one single day.
So mostly in Kawasaki disease, when we give IVIG, we think about monitoring CRP and fever, these two things.
Yes.
May take time actually to come down. So what about in this case where ferritin is high, there other inflammatory markers, RD-dimer is high. So what are the inflammatory marker you will be looking at? Not only fever, or what will be your criteria for deciding that your IVIG working or not working?
Simple formula, ma'am. If the patient is clinically improving, his oxygen saturation is coming down, if the patient neurological state is improving, if the patient's renal or cardiac, myocarditis or pericarditis is improving, means if he's showing any clinical improvement within that 24 hours, we have to, we don't have to give the second dose. If the patient is same and the inflammatory markers are hardly any, you know, they have not come down sufficiently, means maybe 10%, 20%. We have to repeat the dose because we have to give a chance. If we do not treat the patient as it is, the patient is going to have the complications. But if we give the second dose, you might never know, that patient may come back again. That's why we have to give a chance to the patient by giving him second dose if he has not shown any clinical or lab improvement within the first 24 hours.
So, Dr. Himanshu, if IVIG is not working, is there, like in Kawasaki disease, we think about the steroid, we think about the infliximab, we think about the other this thing also. So what about in MIS, if IVIG is not working, or maybe even if it is working, would you like to start with steroids also, because there is some kind of autoimmunity going on?
As we have seen the high level of the inflammatory marker in this condition, which is similar to HLH. So we prefer methylprednisolone in these cases if we are seeing the high levels of all the inflammatory marker, and more so if IVIG we have seen that no response in fever in 36 hours, either we repeat the IVIG or we straight away start with the steroids. And methylprednisolone is usually used in subcenter. They are using it as a pulse therapy for the 3 days, or it can be used 1 to 2 mg/kg, that is routine dose, for a few days followed by tapering. And if it is still not working, and IL-6, that is tocilizumab, and that other options are also available.
So what are your red flag sign, Dr. Himanshu, once you are dealing with a COVID MIS? So what are your red flag sign where you think that you have to go for multi-therapy with multiple anti-inflammatory drugs, roll up like brufen maybe, so all those things. So when, what are your red flag sign?
Any child who is severe enough to require ICU admission in the first place, having shock, requiring inotropes, and high ferritin levels, which are the, one of the prognostic markers seen in France study as well, they have seen that older child and with more than 1400 microgram per liter of ferritin, they are more prone to develop severe disease. So in these cases, we have to consider methylprednisolone early rather than wait.
So you will go by biochemical markers and the clinical distinct like blood pressure and all those things.
And myocardial injury as well, that proBNP and other levels. So the markers of inflammation will be a guide to us, and along with that, the requirement of inotropes definitely.
So when will you intubate a child in this case?
Any patient with a...
Prefer to go for high flow oxygen. What will you do? Like in adults.
We have to follow same guideline as we are following in the sepsis also. If any patient is in shock and having altered sensorium, we will definitely prefer endotracheal intubation.
You are not shy of intubating a patient if you need to, but mostly like you will try to manage with high flow oxygen as we do in adults. Huh? Yes. So we'll follow same guideline for the oxygen therapy.
Yes.
Right. So coming to role of anticoagulation, Dr. Bakuni, anticoagulation, low molecular weight heparin, we give aspirin in the Kawasaki disease so often. So what is your opinion about that?
Luckily, ma'am, in this Miss C, the incidence of coagulopathy is less. However, if the D-dimers are raised and if there is a prothrombotic state, we must give low molecular weight, this thing, heparin. Or naproxen is also, is recommended. Low molecular weight heparin acts also as a anti-inflammatory drug. It also acts as a, it reduces the endothelial injury. So that also helps to the COVID patient. And last but not the least, it also acts like an antiviral agent. How? Because it competes with the virus for the binding site in AS2 inhibitors. So AS2 receptor, sorry. So it acts three ways. So all the benefits are there. If there's a prothrombotic state or the D damage there, we must give low molecular weight heparin to the MIS-C child.
So we know that in coronary artery disease, there is a kind of endothelial damage, then there might be a medial edema, there may be a panarthritis kind of situation. Yes. All these conditions actually are very procoagulant, because there may be chances of having the small thrombus formation in within the coronary arteries and within the other middle sized arteries across the body. So definitely, and actually Kawasaki himself wrote later that it's not only artery but the veins can also be involved.
Yes.
So this is definitely, as you said, it is very, very important to start with low molecular weight heparin or something like that. So just prevent those complications which may be very, very damaging, like there may be a cardiac event or there might be chance of amputations in the peripheral arteries are involved. So this is very important point you have raised, Dr. Bakuni, that LMWH is very important associate. Ancillary treatment for the sick baby. So role of anti-inflammatory drug like ibuprofen and thalidomide, Dr. Himanshu.
Thalidomide has been tried in two studies now also, and previously also it was used as an anti-inflammatory agent. It is known to reduce the fibrosis in the lungs as well, and to decrease the inflammation in the lungs. So that's why its role has been tried in with patient without developing ARDS. So it is definitely can be tried. As far as we haven't achieved a definitive treatment so far, so two trials are ongoing and maybe the result will come soon. And regarding ibuprofen, it is not that much recommended, and it is not that potent anti-inflammatory. Initially also concern were raised regarding its relation with the AST.
But actually, Dr. Himanshu, a trial has been started in the London and in the UK. Institute for ibuprofen, because initially they said that brufen should not be used, then subsequently, like, this is what is happening with the COVID-19 all the time. Something is was like initially they said ACE inhibitor are not indicated, now they say that you should give whatever medicine you are giving. Now they initially said brufen you withhold, now they are saying nahi, we are going for trial. It may be it may reduce the dose of steroid.
There is a different formulation which is more GI friendly using that in the trial.
Maybe I think mostly. Then coming back to role of remdesivir, Dr. Bakuni.
Yes. The role of remdesivir is definitely there. In fact, US FDA has approved it around 2 weeks back It is given to almost all the patients who are sick, who are very sick rather. It's a 5 days course. And it has, the studies have shown, over 3 days back, the study was published that it has increased the recovery time by 31%, meaning thereby, instead of those patients who are recovering without remdesivir in 15 days, after giving remdesivir with the other arm, they recovered in 11 days. So that is a significant improvement of 4 days. I mean, it saves a lot of money to the patient, a lot of money to the government, and a lot of improvement the patient goes home early. So it has a definitive role in almost all the cases. That's why this drug has been approved. In India also, it is being given to the patients at COVID hospitals, at few centers, I believe.
So this is this drug, like there are drugs which will reduce the viral load. There are drugs which will reduce the inflammatory response. So this drug, where it stands actually?
Well, the studies are still on, ma'am, because other studies which are going around 2 months back, they all showed good results. That's why in a hurry, it has been approved to save the lives. It definitely reduces the viral load, as you said, and the inflammatory markers also come down. We don't know how, but it is beneficial, and it has shown the early discharge of the patient, and the patient becomes they recover fast. That's all we know at the moment about this.
Is there any movement to make this drug in India?
I believe few companies, they have got the license from the original, I'm forgetting the name of that company, Gilead or something like that. So because that's
the
common...
probably Jubilant is trying to get it.
I don't know. Having some collaboration in Bangladesh, in Pakistan, in India also. So I think very shortly it will be available in our country, cheaper rate.
Is any other drug comes in your mind, Dr. Bhakuni? Any other cheaper alternative drug? Can you think of which is being promoted nowadays?
No, initially in Jaipur, if you remember, when the Italian patients came, ma'am, they gave ritonavir and lopinavir combination of HIV drug, and the doctors, they claimed that they improved the patient. But subsequently, it has been proven that they have these anti-HIV drugs, they do not have any role. So now the other fad is hydroxychloroquine plus azithromycin. I think regarding that, Dr. Himanshu Batra has already told you. Other drugs, ma'am, all... it's not very much recommended. Of course, if you talk about without tocilizumab, anakinra is the other drug which is being given as a IL-1 inhibitor drug. And of course, the anti-TNF drug is also, infliximab also is being given in few patients who are not recovering either after tocilizumab or after anakinra. So that in cytokine storm, the three cytokines which are to be blamed are IL-6, IL-1 and tumor necrosis factor. So infliximab is one of the drugs which can be used.
So in role of anti-HIV drug, Dr. Himanshu, what is your opinion on that?
No, the anti-HIV drug, actually they are protease inhibitor and they can reduce a step where the virus replicates, that coronavirus replicates. It replicates by producing the enzyme, which is essential to gain entry into the cells also. So they can act, at least pharmacologically we see that thing. But the trials haven't proved this to be that much effective. And another drug which we can think of is ivermectin actually. So ivermectin is also known in some studies to reduce the viral replication or reduce the number or load in some studies. So that is one of the cheaper option, and maybe in India we can try on that thing, but still we have to do studies for that thing.
So Dr. Bhakuni, we are coming back to your own very a drug which you are very fond of, where you've taken so many times the name of this drug, that is the tocilizumab. So talk about it a little more.
It's a wonderful drug, as we have been using it in rheumatoid arthritis, especially in GRM, I mean Still's disease. It's a wonderful drug, Still's disease, as well as giants in arthritis also, Takayasu arthritis also, it is effective. So similarly, as I told you, cytokine storm, the most common IL-6, they found the level in the blood.
Roche
in India, I think it is being procured by Cipla,
Pfizer,
to China,
and they found it very effective in that.
Yeah, so it has improved the survival rate 54% against 44%. And if you give tocilizumab, ma'am, within 12 to 14 hours, the oxygen requirement comes down, saturation improves. improves, the TLC goes up, TLC improves rather, it becomes normal side, and the X-ray chest findings of the opacity, they also come down. And if they don't, as I told you, we have to repeat the dose because we have to give a chance to the patient. It's a wonderful drug. Promoting it, but the evidence shows that it has really improved the survival by 54% against 44%.
So for a very sick patient, it's kind of first line drug.
Yes, yes.
So what is the herd immunity, Dr. Aman?
Herd immunity is seen in many infectious diseases. So it is actually when most of the population has having immunity or is already infected with a particular agent. So they prevent the spread to other who are not immune or are getting exposed to it first time. So for like measles, chickenpox, we are already saying this is very much in understanding. So for herd immunity, either we need a certain amount of population to be affected or vaccine. So vaccine is the best option to create the herd immunity. Like we have seen in the cases of polio, measles. So we are all able to nearly eradicate or reach to the level of elimination because of this herd immunity only. If we say 50-70% population is already immune, so they will prevent other 20-30% to catch that infection by breaking the link between the carrier and the unimmunized person.
Dr. Smita, your microphone is off.
Your microphone.
So both of you, tell me, we keep on saying there are no formation of protective antibodies. Still we are talking about herd immunity. Still we are talking about flattening up curve. In many places like Wuhan itself, then Italy, then Spain, even UK is going down now. So how it is possible if there is no protective antibodies, then how herd immunity can be generated for COVID-19?
Yeah, the answer is of course complicated, ma'am. Firstly, as we told that neutralizing antibodies are not effective. That means the herd immunity by the infection itself will not come. Most likely not. I'm not saying will not, most likely. How the herd immunity will come will be by after vaccination only. If the vaccination program is successful and most of the people of the population, if it is vaccinated, then the herd immunity is possible to save the people who did not have the vaccine and those who were vulnerable. Meaning thereby, just by getting that I had COVID infection and I say 10 out of 10, say if 8 of us we had COVID infection, and can we save those 2 people? No. As on date, the neutralizing antibodies have not been found effective. However, if 10 out of 10 people are given vaccination, that means we are protected. And if we are sorry, 8 out of 10 are given vaccination. And out of those 10, 2 people can be saved because of antibodies which have been produced by vaccination, not by the infection.
Dr. Bhagni, you are expert in this field. That is what I am asking. I am contesting this statement everywhere. Okay. The reason is why there is flattening up curve without any vaccination in Spain, Italy, Wuhan, everywhere. Why there is a flattening up curve if the protective antibodies are not forming? Are there is a chance they are there?
The answer is, ma'am, Wuhan, China, we cannot believe their statement, so that is out. What about European countries? What you told, Spain, France, this thing, they had the worst of peak and they started having their SOPs for the treatment. Number 3, most important, at their lockdown as well as the practices of the population there. They listen to their government. They do what they have been taught. They do all the social distancing, they wash their hands, all those procedures, which we hesitate and our population also hesitate. You have seen all the migration. We have seen wherever some ration is being distributed, hordes of people they go, but not in those countries because their population is less. Financially they are well. Education wise they are much better than us. Fourthly, their discipline is there in their citizen. In our country, well, I'm from the army background, we have the discipline, but not the others. Pardon me by saying that.
Haven't you seen the US?
Sorry.
Didn't you see US?
Yes, Yeah, but US, we can say that since they do not, they have not kept the discipline which they were known for. Now their numbers, you can see, they are topping the list. They are getting the gold medal in the infection because they are not following their discipline. Whereas European countries, they followed, and that's why the flattening of curve, maybe because of that. That is my conjecture.
Can we start a blanket treatment in Dr. Himanshu, because we are getting like many pediatrician we talk to and they say that you are looking at many ILI, influenza-like illnesses, where it is really difficult to differentiate, is it a COVID or it's a influenza itself, flu virus. So can you tell me, shouldn't we start treating them with azithromycin, which is a very regular drug for the pediatrics? And if by chance they have COVID, they may respond. So do you think the azithromycin for children for any ILI is a valid option?
No, I still don't feel. In the mild cases, they are anyway recover within 2-3 days, like most of the virus. Only when we consider it as secondary bacterial infection, like chlamydia or other thing also happening, fever getting prolonged, we consider azithromycin. But as a blanket treatment, we can't start giving that.
Okay, so you won't prefer to start azithromycin as a blanket one like ILI. Will, if you find that there is something which you think that requires azithromycin, so your like those restricted use of azithromycin, that is suggesting. So now coming back to, I think, what are the chances of having coronary artery involvement in children, Dr. Himanshu?
In the studies which are published from the UK, where they have seen more than around 100 cases, so they have noted around 20-30% have developed coronary changes. Either even those cases which are not fitting in the Kawasaki disease, just having fever and raised inflammatory marker, they were also showing in the echo the coronary artery dilatation. So that's why they are telling that even if the children having the fever and no other fitting criteria for shock or for Kawasaki, they should also be screened regularly by the echo for the finding of the coronary artery changes. So around 20-30% is the rate which they have detected.
So how often you would recommend, or how early you will recommend a echo for a patient MISC?
After hospitalization, within 24 hours, we will prefer the first echo, and then depending on the changes, we can plan subsequently.
Good. So coming to last question, what is the status of vaccine, Dr. Bhavan?
Yeah, last but not the least, one of the most important question, ma'am. If you see that today's newspaper, it has in a front page, it has come that the Chinese company Sinovac is going to start the phase 3 trial of its vaccine on 9,000 people in after 2 weeks in Brazil, because there is active infection going on. Basically, they are using the killed virus vaccine, and which has, they had, I think there were two arms. They gave on 0 day and 14 days. And in this arm, they found neutralizing antibodies in those volunteers in phase 2 trial. After a week or so, they will have the results of the second arm, where they injected the patient with on 0 day and on 28th day. So they are going to have a phase 3 trial in Brazil. Most probably it may take 1 or 2 months or 3 months, although it takes usual time, it would have taken 1 to 4 years. Similarly, a US company known as, I think, Moderna, it is using messenger RNA 1273, and they have also shown neutralizing antibodies in volunteers, and they are also going for the phase 3 trial in July, in the month of July, and 30,000 patients have been enrolled already. 9,000 by Chinese in Brazil and 30,000 by Americans for the third phase. Similarly, Oxford AstraZeneca is also coming, because they have also found neutralizing antibody. They are also going for the phase 3 trial, and Johnson & Johnson also going to recruit 10,000 people for the phase 3 trial. In one sentence, if I may say that, all the the companies which are there for the vaccine production, they have cleared the phase 2, they are going for phase 3 trial, and they have demonstrated neutralizing antibodies in good number of volunteers. Probably we may have a vaccine by early this year or maybe end of this year.
So that's my question from both of you, tell me any coronavirus where you got a very effective vaccine.
Sorry, please repeat the question, ma'am.
Coronavirus, any coronavirus where you got a very effective vaccine? SARS one? No.
We didn't.
We didn't. Huh? And the other like the Ebola and all, we didn't get vaccine. The influenza vaccine is even not very effective because you have to just take it. So how optimistic you are that COVID-19 vaccine is going to work?
In this period of gloom, this is a period of gloom all over the world, not in India or Europe or something. So some good news is a very good news. Even if it's a little bit good news, because it makes the highlight, it makes a headline in the newspaper, as I was telling you, in Hindustan Times today, I saw that news, maybe in other newspapers also. So anything good, anything which can contribute to the treatment or prevention of COVID-19, even in adults or in children, will be a good news, and I think we should be hopeful. We should not lose hope.
So Dr. Himanshu, what will you do to improve your immunity? People say like COVID-19 had a chance in human race because we were falling, like we were failing in our dietary part, our exercise part, and we were not keeping up with our immunity part. So our innate immunity, we were not doing anything to actually enhance that. So now everybody says, even Chinese paper have shown that the antibodies and virus both can coexist even for 40 days, and particularly in asymptomatic patients. So these are the kind of paper coming up, and they say that is your innate immunity is the only thing which will help you. That is why they are like talking about the traditional Chinese medicine in their protocol, traditional TCM. Traditional Chinese medicine is the first line of treatment, and in few of the trials are going on. So what about our trials, about the Ayurveda, about the homeopathy, the yoga? So is there any role of these kind of things? Healthy diet, masala in kitchen, is it working for us? BCG, polio. So there are a lot of questions about the people are saying ki India people are more resistant to COVID-19. People are saying so. So tell me about general points. What are your opinion? Both.
Which is in favor of the innate immunity stronger in India children is BCG vaccine, because BCG is routinely given in India. And we know that the mechanism by which act as a boost innate immunity, or the initial, that is first contact with the antigen. So it is already strong. Second, with the multiple viral infection and vaccines which are used for other viral infection, this also enhances our innate immunity to other viruses also, to the most of the extent. Although there are few contradictory reports regarding influenza vaccine, but still we are in favor of using influenza vaccine rather than going by that paper. And other things which are coming from the mortality data of the US and other countries, the races which are more affected are those who lack vitamin D or have less sunlight exposure. So role of vitamin D is definitely also coming in India, that vitamin D definitely can help in boosting immunity. So that is one part. And other things, in the allopathic only we can say that vitamin C is zinc. These are all known to enhance our immunity. That is things we can always advise if anybody wants to use it. Although balanced diet is nothing can take place the role of balanced diet actually.
Traditional kadha. So I just want to know, Dr. Bhagwani, what is this trained immunity? What is about the training of your immune system? Trained immunity. People say that BCG, it trains your immunity. Because you give multiple vaccinations, so children are very adaptive that way, and that is why they are fighting with the COVID-19 in better way. What is this training of immune system or immunity? What I'm asking here, does it really work, giving BCG and getting better results?
Ma'am, firstly, all these are anecdotal reports. And there is no definitive study going on anywhere in the world where they have, except at one place, that is, I think in Russia, they are seeing whether BCG vaccination really helped them or not. Otherwise, just hearsay, or I'll just keep, just because we are not having so many tests in our country. So we do not know exactly, are our children really being safe from COVID-19 or not? and BCG, of course, because everyone is having BCG, so it's coming just like that. There is no scientific evidence or no scientific paper I could lay my hands on where it says that BCG and other immunization are helpful for protecting our children or children in our country. So if I say something, you know, dogmatically, I think I'll be wrong, which I don't want to.
So Sakshi, be ready next rapid fire round.
Be ready to give me hamper.
So breast milk does not contain COVID-19.
Yes.
Express breast milk is preferred with hand hygiene for baby of affected mother.
Yes.
Mother must be separated till she is febrile for 72 hours. Two nasal swab is negative and has a no respiratory.
No, no. She's not.
Only precautions are needed, but as per the WHO, we will definitely prefer in India or in our country.
If mother is COVID positive, newborn must be given immediate bath.
No.
If mother is COVID positive, then I'm asking. No, you think no.
Both. I said.
Yes. We should.
Both, huh? Okay. So children with MISC who have raised cardiac angina are more critical.
Yes.
Children with COVID may have myocarditis, cardiogenic shock.
Yes.
COVID positive children may have myocardial infarction early.
Yes. Wo bhi answer yes, sir.
COVID positive children may develop coronary artery aneurysm and may need long-term antiplatelet therapy. Low molecular weight heparin must not be given to critically ill children with MISC.
That should be
given. It should be given.
So to summarize today's session, thank you very much, Dr. Himanshu, and thank you very much, Dr. Bhakuni. So now this is very clear that we have definite involvement of the critical involvement of the children by this COVID-19. It may not be direct infection, but it may be a kind of autoimmunity or immune system which actually works against a child, just like in the Kawasaki disease. But is Kawasaki disease is not a COVID-19 MIS. It is something different from, it is more expanded, it is more dangerous. So definitely one has to be very careful once a family is having COVID-19 infection. So children should be kept away. The proper social hygiene is important. Hand washing is very, very important way of keeping away. One month back, we were thinking that children should be kept at a distance from the older people because they may be a carrier. And this is in few of the studies, they said they can be even for a longer time, they may have a nasopharyngeal distance, though this virus may not enter in their lung, causing a severe pneumonia as it happens in the adults. But it may persist in the nasopharyngeal swab, and that's how they remain probable carrier, and they can cause illness in the older people of the family, grandparents, the parents who are diabetic, hypertensive and all. But now we know that children themselves may have some kind of serious illness. And it is very important if they develop some kind of rashes, conjunctivitis, or something like they are having respiratory difficulty or gastroenteritis. And when you know there is some kind of exposure, because still Indian government is saying that we are not reached to phase 3, we are not having community transmission. So we must have, we have to have a contact for calling it a COVID-19. So that is what. So we have to be very careful. We have to, once the baby is in a child, is, infants are more serious sufferer than the pediatric age group. And if they are there, then we have to use all our armor, whatever medicine. Azithromycin can be a good thing preliminary if ILI, influenza-like illness, maybe having some prophylactic role. There are many things, like I was looking at data of hydroxychloroquine. Hydroxychloroquine is being opposed by so many publications so strongly. They are fighting tooth and nail against the hydroxychloroquine. So in UK and US, these are the two places. US in unofficially they are using, but UK is not using hydroxychloroquine at all. But the other places, if you see Iran, if you see Italy, if you see China, even in China, and as early as February, they said that hydroxychloroquine may be more effective than the Remdesivir itself. So they said so. So hydroxychloroquine, these are the unofficial repurposed drug. We call them repurposed drug, and we have to use them. We have to be very careful where we are using, what precaution we are taking. ECG, if it is required, should be taken. If ICU care is required, should be taken. So it is a very, very tough time. COVID-19 pandemic. Now this is very clear in June 15th that children are not immune to bad effect of COVID-19.
Yes.
So that is so the social distancing, as Dr. Bhakuni said, Dr. Himanshu said, that nothing else will work. Even vaccine may not come up. So till then, if we are having our hand hygiene, we are having the social distancing, and we are isolating, we are doing quarantine, we are not opening up a school for a while till we are in a very stable situation. So if we do all those things, probably we are going to skip the major mortality and morbidity due to COVID-19. So anything else you two want to convey?
I think you covered the activities of the today's webinar very well, ma'am. I think both of us and you also, all three of us has covered almost all the aspects of this disease in this limited particular time. I think I must thank you for conducting a very nice way.
Thank you.
Okay, so we can leave.
Yes, thank you. Any questions to me?
No.
Can you see the question answers, ma'am, if there are some questions?
No, a question I'm not getting in my this thing.
Dr. Vikas Taneja question, how to ascertain that Kawasaki disease is due to COVID?
I am not looking at this,
It is there, ma'am. I'll repeat the question. Dr. Vikas Taneja is asking, how to ascertain that Kawasaki disease is due to COVID? Because most of the times COVID RT-PCR is negative. We also had a case of Kawasaki disease treated with IVIG, but its COVID test was negative. The answer to it is that, Dr. Vikas, if you are listening, that as I told you, the COVID exposure is around 2 to 4 weeks before the patients, the children are involved. So COVID test may be negative or it may be positive also. There was one study where 60% patient, they had positive, immunoglobulins as well as positive PCR. 33% patient, they have only positive PCR, negative PCR, but only immunoglobulin is positive. And around 7% patient, they are negative for both. So meaning thereby, if we talk in simple term, it is like reactive arthritis, as I told you earlier. It is a post-infectious complication. Kawasaki disease-like features are the post-infectious complication of COVID.
Please depend on the IgG presence. If you are having the antibody seropositivity, that is what, like in rheumatic fever, we look for the ASLO titer. Ajay?
Yeah, second question is, again, Dr. Vikas Taneja, studies have shown that tocilizumab can reduce the severity of disease in the initial phase, but how much impact is had on mortality is still not established. What is your opinion on this? I think I made myself clear that it has increased the survival rate from 54% versus 44%. So the patient get discharged in 11 days rather than on 15 days, and it helps to come over the cytokine storm. So this is definitely a good drug. Dr. Vikas Taneja, another question is, double dose of IVIG of second dose, close of IVIG, yeah, the same dose of 2 gram per kg body weight in one day we have to give. Anonymous.
Hello.
are still cases of COVID in association with Kawasaki relation found in India? Are still you answer?
No, initially only we have reported in the April 2 cases, one from the Chennai and one from the Kolkata, but these are not actually associated with COVID at that time, because the pattern what we are seeing in the from the US and Europe, it is occurring 2 weeks after the Kawasaki, and now in India we are at a peak stage, so we can expect this kind of association maybe sometime later, maybe after 2-3 weeks.
Upar karo questions. Dr. Virkas Taneja again, if antibodies are not protective, is there a chance of reinfection? Of course, yes. The chances of reinfection will always be there. As on date, we have not proven that these antibodies are protective. Next question, 5-year-old child negative but parent positive, what to do? 5-year-old child COVID negative but parents positive.
Want to answer? Okay. Now, if the parents are positive, they have to definitely have to take help of some caregiver who can take care of the child if child is negative so far, and home isolation if the
I'm going to read question, rest of questions I have got this, huh? So Bhakuni, good word for you. Just want to say, Dr. Bhakuni, you have inspired me to take up rheumatology and I follow you on Instagram. Thank you, sir.
Most welcome. I am really pleased to increase one of the, you know, in our society, one more member as rheumatology. Thanks, whosoever you are, most welcome to join our very fascinating, you know, a super specialty or subspecialty, because rheumatology is nothing but a good internal medicine person who knows a little bit extra than the others. Thank you very much for joining us.
Have you dealt with this question? 5-year child COVID negative but parents positive, what to do?
No, we have to first see the parents whether they have only mild symptom or can be managed at home, and regarding care of the child who is still negative, we have to just keep on observing him for any symptom, and strict mask usage, strict hand hygiene, isolation if possible, and a separate caregiver if anybody at the home is also not negative, or if you have some arrangement to take care of the child in the situation, that will be better. And regarding testing of the child, it needs to be repeated as a protocol which is followed by the government presently. Keep within 5 to 10 days, if you have first test is negative, we have to see for the symptom. Any symptom come, then we have to give the treatment as well as repeat test. Otherwise, we can repeat the test at 10th for the child.